Now, this was a massive haul. 560 kilos of shabu worth 3.8 billion pesos. Is it fair to say at this point that Subic can be considered as a drug smuggling hotspot or port?
Well, Karen, personally, my opinion is that the Subic Freeport is now being used by some syndicates, not just with the smuggling of drugs, but also smuggling of other products, including agricultural products. Rice, I think earlier this year, there were rice that were smuggled via Subic. So it seems that there is a problem with the customs area in that part of the country, in Central Luzon. So maybe we should make it more stringent, no, for importers, not to process documents of their goods that they are that are being imported to the Philippines, Karen.
Okay. But then the SBMA chair, Mr. Tan, was quite defensive over this. And he said it was a customs officer in Subic who, in effect, discovered the shipment.
Well, you know, in fairness to Mr. Tan, he's just new in the area. No, he's probably not aware yet of what transpired for the last maybe 6 years or maybe 10 years. But I'm sure he is being briefed by his staff, no, that there are contrabands that pass through Subic Freeport. And he should not close his eyes on this. He knows that some illegal contrabands and syndicates, including drug syndicates, are using the Freeport as to the Philippines by importing illegal contrabands as well. So okay. I guess, in fairness to him, no, he's not probably well aware yet at the moment. He's just new in the job. So maybe we'll give him more time.
Okay, as the chairman of the Dangerous Drugs Committee in the lower house, would you say our situation with illegal drugs has worsened today?
Honestly,
they put it to 6 years ago during former President Duterte's drug war.
I guess it improved a little, Karen, no? Because look at all these apprehensions made by PIDEA, NDI, PNP, Drug Enforcement Group. These are all large hauls, no? Including this one. This is a 560 kilos. There was a 990 kilos. There was a lot of massive apprehensions made by the law enforcers during this administration. This is a continuing program, Karen. They continued the programs of the last administration, and these are all products of their operations. So I guess it is fair to say that it is improved, no? So to speak.
Okay, but what would you say is the biggest challenge in the Philippines? Is it because we're an archipelago? Anywhere where there's water, you can actually ship or smuggle. That's one. Another issue is the customs itself.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Are you seeing the gap?
Well, first, you're correct. No, we're an archipelago, so there are a lot of entry points and exit points, no? And because we're too porous, the country is too porous, meaning there's a lot of way where they can smuggle all these goods, all these drugs. So it's very difficult for us, no, to guard all our the whole territory. In fact, ito po yung West Philippines nga, hindi natin nabantayan. There was already a military establishment constructed by China. So it's really very difficult for us. In fairness, sa ating Coast Guard, sa ating Navy, they've been doing their jobs. No? They've been monitoring our seas, our territorial boundaries. Unfortunately, there's still a lot, you know, corruption is the root of all this, Karen. No? Some members of the law enforcers are being corrupted by the syndicates, which make it easy for them to bring in the illegal drugs into the country. So another Well, aside from the archipelago being porous, yes, I agree with you that customs is another problem. No? Though they've been initiating cleansing among their ranks, they've been extricating all these members of the bureau that are found to be in cahoots with syndicates, or some are being charged for corruption. So this is a continuing battle as well, Karen. And we need the information and participation of the people in this fight because corruption is draining the resources of the country.
Okay, and then after that, we talk about 560 kilos of shabu that was seized. Another find was 200 kilos that was found in a car at a supermarket in Pampanga. I mean, and you mentioned another seizure, I believe, something like 900 kilos. Staggering numbers, but the big question is this. What does PDEA do with the drugs? This is the bigger issue. If it is set aside, then there's belief that it just goes back into the market.
Well, I will not deny the fact, Karen, that there are, as I said, no, corrupt enforcers, law enforcers that are in cahoots with the drug syndicates. In fact, one of the recent investigations that the committee did is we investigated the 990 kilos of shabu found in the possession of a police officer. And this is continuing, Karen. No? There are a lot of law enforcers still that are in cahoots with the drug syndicates and trying to recycle all these drugs. Well, the law is very clear. No, once it is apprehended, it is immediately inventoried. After the inventory, it will present to the court as evidence. Within 24 hours, the court will do an ocular inspection. And once the ocular inspection is done, it is certified by the laboratory of PDEA that it is indeed drugs. Then immediately within 74 hours, it should be destroyed.
And all of it. It should be destroyed, all of it. Okay.
That's probably just leave some. No, maybe a gram or 2 grams or something like that.
Good point. Okay, so ang tanong dito, Congressman Barbers, after the process, it should be destroyed. How? Burning, thrown into the river?
Burning
dapat.
Yeah, burning. It's incineration. It's an incineration.
Ang tanong ngayon, have you actually witnessed an incineration? Like itong 990 kilos, was this incinerated?
Yes, it was already incinerated sometime in, if I'm not mistaken, it was done in April, probably May. I forgot the days. I wasn't there, but it was all over. What PDEA does is that all the apprehended drugs, let's say for a quarter, they all burn it all at the same time.
But how could you be sure? You're not sure anymore kung shabu yun. Pwedeng asukal yun, or flour yun, harina yun. Di mo na alam.
No, merong representative ang Department of Justice dyan. Merong representative yung PNP dyan. Merong representative yung PDEA Crime Lab.
So, Congressman, they cannot check every kilo.
Yeah. Well, you know what they do is that every before they throw a kilo, for instance, no, in the incinerating plant, what they do is they check it, and then they show proof that this is drugs. So before they throw it there into the fire, so there are a lot of ways to do that. No, in fact, before they bring the evidence, all this evidence in the incineration plant, what they do is that they send chemists to check it with witnesses all over. So it's even media is present in the incineration process. So, but you know, there's still, I guess, the drugs that are being recycled is not those drugs that are already inside and being kept already by the evidence room. No, what we discovered in the last investigation we did is that when a drug is apprehended, say, for instance, in Quezon City, there's a kilo of drugs in one of the houses, what they will present as evidence is only half, and half will be recycled. That is the drug recycling scheme that some scalawags in the law enforcement units are doing.
Okay.
And that's good.
Oh, now, Congressman, is this the right drug policy for the Philippines? During President Duterte's time, many critics have said it was too harsh, it's ineffective. So when President Marcos came into power, he actually, and I'm reading a quote, he said he would change focus, catch bigger fish, and the war on drugs he described is less bloody and more holistic. Number one, is that the way to go? And are you seeing his promises true on the ground?
Well, honestly, if we're going to base all the apprehended illegal drugs from the time that the President BBM has started this administration, you would see that there are large apprehended illegal drugs that were made during his administration. This, as I stated earlier, this is a continuing intelligence operations that were done by the law enforcers for the last 6 years. So ito na yung product. No? This is the product of the intelligence operations. And I guess there's no perfect anti-illegal drug policy. Of course, it would always be safer for us to stay in the more humane side. But, these are drug syndicates and these people are willing to kill. So if we do not, we will not defend or allow our law enforcers to defend themselves, then we might end up losing in this drug war. So I guess it is inevitable that there are times that shooting happens and killing happens too.
Okay, so what gap are you seeing? Let's talk about Singapore, for example. Singapore, a very small country. I mean, for sure, there may be attempts, right, to smuggle drugs in, but it would be too difficult or perhaps dangerous because of the death penalty. Are you seeing the death penalty as a real deterrent to drug smuggling?
I've been proposing that since 11th Congress, Karen. I've been pushing for the restoration of death penalty only
on traffickers,
drug cases. Drug cases. Well, we might probably include, if given a choice, I would ask Congress to maybe include plunderers, those that are being convicted for plunder. Of course, those heinous crimes.
Pero hindi na papasayan kung sinama mo pa yung plunderer. Eh, posibleng ang dami sa...
But,
but let's talk about drugs. Okay, the possibility, let's say the death penalty, it's only drugs, right? If you take it one crime at a time, there's a bigger chance. But, for example, traffickers, drug smugglers, right, drug importers, what's the possibility? Because you go to Singapore, you're on the plane, and really, before landing, you're going to hear drug use and trafficking is punishable by death in Singapore. Kumbaga may warning.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah. Well,
it's addressed to foreigners.
Kaya nga some of the Singaporeans are the ones na lang bringing drugs outside of their country. Like just last week or 2 weeks ago, two Singaporeans who's trying to smuggle in cocaine. No? So, I guess it could be a deterrent. No, death penalty could be a deterrent. That's why there is really a need to study the revival of the death penalty proposal. So that if we really want to address the problem of illegal drugs, I guess this is one tool, one instrument that can deter the syndicates from trying to bring in all these illegal drugs into the country. But of course, the major reform we should do is to reform the law enforcers unit in trying to maybe perhaps include the moral seminars or morality seminars among all these people, no? Because you know they should understand that a single gram of or an ounce of a drug, once it gets in, it can probably kill someone or probably make someone commit a crime. Because once you're high, you don't know what exactly what you're doing and things like that. So it can be a contributory factor, no, into the crimes that may be committed because they are okay. under the.
Do you have figures, for example, when it comes to apparently online cyber prostitution? The Philippines is said to be number two. That's the latest figure, right? I mean, when it comes to illegal drugs importation, have we changed? Are we at a higher standing? Because there are no specific numbers. Even international studies I've been researching, they can't seem to detect or find specific number of drug users in the country.
Mm-hmm. Well, based on the figures that were surveyed, no, that came out, no, that in the last 6 years, there was about, if I remember correctly, about 4 million drug dependents, no, in the country. In fact, these are subjected to Operation Oplan Tokhang, no, where the PNP, PIDEA, and other law enforcement units are asking these people in the community to undergo a drug rehab, community drug rehab program. Today, as we speak, Karen, I have no exact numbers, no, as to how many have been rehabilitated or how many have gone back again to using drugs and things like that. So maybe that's a good statistics that we should get, no, from the law enforcers. And I will ask them to do that and submit that to us. But as far as the country is concerned, when asked about its status of being a drug, quote unquote, drug country, we're still ashamed because there are other countries that are already manufacturing, mm-hmm. exporting, and we're not in that stage yet, Karen. And hopefully we will not that stage.
Okay. Another question is the confidential funds. The budget was passed as is with 10.4 billion in confidential funds. The leadership of the House has stated that they may remove funds from civilian agencies and move it to protectors of the West Philippine Sea. I'll start first with intelligence for drugs. Is there enough? What did you fight for? Yeah.
Well, yes, we still need additional intelligence funds, no, for our law enforcers, no, especially those that are tackling and running after drug syndicates. It's still a significant amount that they enjoy, no, so to speak, but we still need more. Because you're fighting a syndicate, it is a global syndicate, so it's not very easy to catch them without having intelligence funds. So there is a need really to increase the budget of the intelligence operatives in the law enforcement units.
But what did they leave with? Would you remember? What did they leave with the PNP when the budget was passed?
I cannot exactly tell you, Karen, the exact figure, but there is quite a significant amount given to them. Okay. So the PNP enjoys the PNP, NBI, and NBI, I'm not so sure whether they have this amount for intelligence, but the PNP, the AFP, and PIDEA, they have their share of intelligence funds. And of course, honestly, I feel that this should be increased too. But the intelligence funds that we were discussing during the budget deliberation is to reallocate a large chunk of the intelligence fund into the agencies that needed it more. For instance, yeah. the agencies that are in charge in the West Philippine Sea. You have the NICA, you have the NSA, you have the AFP, etc., etc. So, so that's where we played it out during the deliberations, Karen.
Okay. All right. I mean, anything you would like to add? I mean, clearly, Subic is a major gateway at this point. What would you recommend? The DOJ has all eyes on Subic, but what would you recommend?
Okay, well, number one, as you said earlier, perhaps a stiffer penalty, no, in the, because we believe that, you know, if Subic is being used as a way into all these illegal drugs, there are people in the Subic area that are in cahoots with the syndicates. So if for penalties, once we catch them, then maybe we start the process. I'm glad that the DOJ is on top of this, because charges will be filed with those that are found to be involved. No? Apparently, there are information as well that there are foreigners that are behind the schemes. There are foreigners here that can do that in the country. I would surmise that, that they are in cahoots with some local officials in the area. So, death penalty is one. So second, intelligence community. No? We need information also from the public. The law enforcers cannot just do it alone. They need information from them. And sometimes you have to buy the information, if you know what I mean, Karen.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today, sir. So are you scheduling a hearing soon?
Yes, we will schedule. The deputy speaker, senior deputy speaker, Aurelio Dong Gonzalez, filed a resolution that we conduct a motu proprio investigation on this particular subject.
On that note, Congressman Robert Ace Barbers, thank you for joining me, sir.
Thank you, Karen. Good morning.